gonna do it? Oh, yeah, yeah. And I'll give you guys plenty of time to make the switch.
Yeah.
I promise.
Okay.
Remember the bongos. You got sticks?
Yeah, I got everything.
I'll take you down a bit. Let's do it. Yeah. Wait, no, like, ba, 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 ba.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Like, ba, ba, da, da, ba, da, yeah. This is our first and last time ever opening with this song, and some of you will get that joke. Seems as if a sad place started out.
none constitute such fiction. It's fiction, it's fiction. I'm losing faith in this place.
Rub alone, rub alone.
Let's do it. Could have imagined it being any other place, and this is just the first of many, many volumes that will come out this night of sentimentality and sadness and hopefulness. This is just the preface of our book. But I just want to say the first bit will be about the setting, and I couldn't imagine it being any other place because all y'all have come to almost all of these Vic Geary shows, and they've all just been one after the other better and better and better. And Let's make this last one because I'm never gonna book this hall ever again. Yeah. This was for this band, and we've made up different lies every single time just to get a rock concert here, and I'm out, man. Nick's sister isn't going to the Netherlands, and she's here tonight. And so if we got caught, you know. All right, so we're gonna keep going with the set, but it was important to have it here. Thank you so much for coming.
Oh,
So that's the one song we get the fuck up tonight, all right? That's the one. Don't worry about it. That's the one we get. This show basically had what I think was everyone in this band's dream lineup. Because it didn't have... It's not that it had, you know, your favorite band of all time or your, you know, the greatest five rock bands in terms of guitar, technique, and nuance. And yeah, and I mean, the Heartbreakers didn't come. But it had every band that we've played with that over our four and three quarters of a year long career paid attention to us completely outside of the internet, completely outside of the occasional acquaintanceship at a show. What it was it was an attention to detail and a friendship that you usually only find in the intimacy of a one-on-one relationship. And, you know, you can all rent American Hardcore or read or watch Instrument or, you know, read some book by a member of some old DIY band and they can talk about community, but you have no idea what it is until you've actually experienced bands calling you on the phone, telling you what they thought of your record, asking you to come over and listen to it with them. Just having an actual musical relationship. These weren't bands that we ever thought we were putting on shows for or playing shows with because we could bring a good crowd. These were bands that we played with because afterwards we'd have the most intoxicatingly beautiful conversations we'd had with anyone in our lives. And I mean that in terms of just every single person that played music tonight in this band and every other band that played. And so I just want to get a big round of applause for every single person that played tonight. Selfishly for what they did for us. But also, you obviously know how talented they all are. So, that was real. Dude, how about that Arches of Loaf cover? Come on.
Not to mention that we've heard people do that song before.
Really badly. Zach came up to me earlier this week and was like, yeah, I've been listening to Icky Meadow for like first couple of times. There's humor. And he was just so pumped there was humor. That was what we were talking about, right?
Yeah.
It's so true. Stop taking your art so seriously, guys. We're going to play two songs now off of our new 7-inch that we have for sale tonight. And it came out yesterday. It's called Ukume, and we're really, really proud of it. Hopefully soon it will be on... line for free download at quote unquote records. We don't know when. Hopefully soon. Imagine if we didn't actually know that for a fact and we were just saying that and we had never talked to them. It'll be there one day.
Oh, it's totally gonna be there.
Let's do it. Oh, wait. This song goes out to Ezra. This song goes out to Ezra for taking a video of it on a flip cam and putting it on the internet, and it's only like 10 seconds long, but I watch that video like 10 times a day for a week to find out the strengths and weaknesses of the intro of this song, and because of Ezra, the intro got cut. And that is really important. I listen to it every day and realize that the intro to this song sucked and that it was a good luck ripoff, and so it got cut. And now the song has a drum intro, introducing Nicholas, Angelo, Provolone, Marone!
Yeah. was a secret. It's like at the end of a relationship, you know, it's like, I totally cheated on you when you lost your job. Like we'll just tell you all the dirty secrets now.
What, you guys haven't heard that before?
I'm sweating tea. I was never really planning on saying this at a show, but this song is about someone that I hold very dear to me. And, yeah, it could be about any one of you, so. But she's gone through a lot of crap, a lot of really, really intense stuff. And this song was written about her at a time where I felt like I could do nothing to help her out. And I think writing the song was a bad idea because and doing art in those situations sort of makes you perpetuate sometimes not being able to do anything. And I think that writing this song and playing this song actually really taught me that, and it made me pick up the phone more often. So I just want to point that out. So this is what that song's about. It's called 45 Minutes from Somewhere Out There. Silence. What did I say? Okay, let's do it. You're gonna do 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. Yeah, okay, cool.
Oh,
those are two tracks off our last release. It's a 7-inch called Ukume. Thanks, Mom and Dad, for taking me to see Jungle the Jungle in an empty theater so that I could experience it and we could name our record Ukume. Jungle the Jungle, starring Tim Allen, 1994 Disney flick, maybe 96. IMDb hates it. I love it. Wait, what's going on? Was that like a wicked good moment? This song's called Bug-Infested Floorboards. It's about moving out of a dirty house in Dover. A really, really dirty house that I didn't live in. But I sure as helped them move all their shit out of it. Thanks a lot, guys. You got this. Yeah. We kept my spoken word bits in there just to keep it from being awkward. I confronted it head on this weekend. Are your brains big enough to get their feelings hurt? Well, me neither.
Go!
is that connection till our last practice.
Is Mr. Rory Sacchettone in the room still?
Yeah.
You ready to take this from me when it comes, right?
I'll do what I do.
We recorded the bits to Rory's, the bits of Rory's in this song in his kitchen in Colin and Rory, well, Colin's first apartment away from home, Rory's second. And in that apartment, I discovered so many things that were such a big deal. And one of the biggest things was sitting in a room after the worst show of our lives in Alston, where a bunch of punks poured Fosters on my pedals, our speakers got blown, and I cried and cried, and it was horrible. And we went home all wet because it was raining, and Rory put on In on the Kill Taker. And it was the first time I had ever heard that Fugazi record. And not only was it the first time I had ever listened to Fugazi, it was the first time that I ever realized why I needed to start listening to records and not my iPod. So this song's for Rory and Colin and Linden Street and that terrible show.
I woke up to that, the sound of him screaming, and it made no sense because that's all you could hear.
Oh yeah, Colin was asleep, and it was like 1 p.m.
While we're on the subject, can I just divulge a little Easter egg?
Yeah, and do it into the mic. And turn the mic on.
If you listen to Just Got Back close enough, Oh, yeah. You can hear the movie Mallrats.
But wait, the reason's the best, because I forgot to shut it off while I recorded all the melodica and toy piano parts, and I didn't want to re-record them.
Goddamn escalator.
That is actually one of them. Probably the only accidental sample other than my parents' washing machine. Which is basically a band member on Masked Dancers because we had no idea what was going on. Let's do it. Let's do it.
Yeah.
thought Ty Ueda was Andrew, and I thought something was wrong, but it was just Ty Ueda. One, and it would mean a lot to me if you sang, "I'm starting to get hoarse."
I think it's the right time to welcome a very, very special guest onto the stage. Mr. Arthur Demersian, are you still here? Are you around?
No.
Get up here, Dad. I want to take this moment before we go into this cover that we're going to play with my dad. Can you lift the keyboard up for a second? I'm going to go over here. To just say that my dad's love of music and love of art and love of people has been a really, really big force in this band for a long time. And my mom's too, but I'll never forget when this band full on decided that it was going to have backing tracks and it was going to be a really, really legitimate thing, or try to be. My dad asked me if I was interested in investing in a PA. It wasn't me who went to my dad and said, okay, my band needs a PA. I think we should get it, because I was 15 at the time. It was my dad who asked me if we thought it would be smart to invest in a PA. And that completely changed our entire ecosystem of thought. And I want to thank you, Dad, for giving us the opportunity to do whatever we wanted in your basement all the time. And for showing me all the best music I've ever known, which is the one and only, the true king of rock and roll, greatest American singer-songwriter, Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. This tune's for my dad, and he is gonna rock your faces off on the drums. All right, who's doing the intro?
Wait, are you gonna do it, or you're gonna do it?
I'll do it.
Cool.
Take it easy, baby.
Thank you so much, Dan. Love you, Dan. Thanks, Mike. Thanks, Laura.
One thing that's always been really, really special, I think, about the Brave Little Abacus being in... Oh, shit, this is getting filmed. The Brave Little Abacus being a band from New Hampshire is that... and a lot of people don't know this, but we became a band right after New Hampshire, because it's a small enough state, really started working to shut down shows and shut down kids from acting in a kind of like DIY, whatever, punk fashion to put on shows because of a company called NH Booking that trashed a lot of venues. And this is okay if this is getting recorded. It's fact. I'm going to make a Wikipedia page about it when I go home. But NH Booking, I went to those shows when I was a kid, and you know, they were my first shows ever, like Sandown Town Hall shows, Dairy Town Hall shows, and windows got broken, things got smashed, and so if you told someone, and the reason why we have to lie about using this hall, that you wanted to put on a show and kids were going to be playing music, there was a lot of intense, very, very sort of like derelict type of pretense that got put around it, and so we were too young to be playing shows with our favorite, like, well, I guess not all of ours, but like my favorite bands of like eighth grade, freshman year type of stuff. But the thing is that we somehow, like, still, with enough people, like, everyone had, like, at least a couple garages where, like, parents were okay with it happening. And so, more so than at those town hall shows and stuff, it was always the same people. Because even the people who didn't like your band were in your classes and were going to go because they could at least hang out at your house on a Friday night instead of doing nothing and playing Xbox or something. And so it became this really, really interesting thing, I think, that we can all agree on. The show's in New Hampshire, I'm saying, that it was always the same faces. And so we kept writing new songs and we kept buying new guitar pedals, but they didn't, and they were always there. And it was like, they all were our best friends. And so it's a really, really interesting thing in that. And we didn't really go all that far out of that with our career. We did, you know, we did a little couple of trips here and there, and I think our music's got promoted, but it's still this. And that's why this is so special to me. And this is why when I look around this room, I know all your names, and I know all who you are, and most of us can say the same thing. And so this being over, I think I want it, and I think we can all say this, to be really different than other bands being over. Because we all know you and we all care about you. It's not, you're not just faces, and you're not just bodies, your relationships and your memories. And I think this band being over will only mean that we won't be playing shows and we won't be putting out records. It won't mean that we can still positively affect each other and we can still know each other. And I really want you guys to know that we all care about you very, very much, and we care about these memories, and that's not, this breakup doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that at all. I'm just saying. So we love you all a lot, and we're gonna play one of our long songs tonight. None of the other ones. That's a false start. Yeah. That's the one. There it is. Just do the beginning of it.
It's official.
Adam.
What?
Four, right? Of the end? Of the six?
Yeah, it'll be like, that could never happen. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
And you'll hit the four, yeah. Treetop. Sorry, I ruined your video tie. Canopy. Branches caress three clouds. Leaving
in time only to breathe. Might just be existing. It might bend at the knees. Then its entire existence is overpassing me. I wanna feel. Thank you.
Wait, what?
Wait, no, we do it up a key. Yeah, just be careful. Be mindful of your thoughts, young Padawan.
Let's do it! Whoa.
Sir.